When the Hawaiians, the Polynesians, got here about 1500 years ago, they didn't find bare rock here. They found a lush tropical paradise with abundant food and resources. And the research that we're doing now is to try to find out why. Everything that came here from somewhere else, because Hawaii is in the center of the Pacific Ocean. And our questions are, how did they get here? Are there stepping stones that we should be protecting that bring biodiversity into Hawaii? And how long ago did they get here? And the reason we want to look at that is, if we're going to protect the biodiversity of Hawaii, we have to protect the origins of that biodiversity, the ways that the biodiversity gets here. I work at Coconut Island at Hawaii Institute of Marine Biology, which is a marine lab for the University of Hawaii. We use genetic technology to look at the natural history of the animals, plants, organisms of the Pacific. We go into the DNA and we can unravel their history. The comparative reef research means that we look at the reefs here in Hawaii and then we look elsewhere in the Pacific. And one of the goals is that we can use pristine reefs, reefs that are in almost perfect condition elsewhere in the Pacific, as a yardstick for the recovery of Hawaiian reefs. A second purpose is to look at those reefs and determine whether they're contributing eggs and larvae that can replenish the reefs and fisheries here in Hawaii. Well, the importance of the Cook Islands expedition was that it just plain showed this was feasible, that we could drop down in a fairly remote location with specialized gear, that we could get helium and other gases shipped there from, in this case, from California. And so now, with that experience behind us, we can go forward and start looking at other places that are important for in terms of biodiversity in the Pacific. We're hoping to go to the Marshall Islands, we're hoping to go to the Philippines, and we're hoping to go to the highest biodiversity hotspot, which is in Indonesia, a place called the Coral Triangle. It's the rainforest of the sea, and nobody's looked down on the deep reefs to see what's there. So our next steps are to organize these expeditions and to go forward and explore these places that no human has ever seen. What I love about the research I do is at the beginning, we have a team that goes out very often to a place that no human beings have ever seen. And so it's the thrill of discovery, seeing something brand new. The privilege is just fantastic. And then after that, there's months and months of lab work, mostly done by graduate students and postdocs. There's months and months of paper shuffling and reports and permits. But then at the end of that, we discover something that no one else knows. Something like the Opihi here in Hawaii. We discovered that they arrived here from Japan 2 to 3 million years ago, that they rafted over. And at the end of every one of these projects, there's a special moment where you know something that's important that no one else knows, and now you get to go forward and tell the world. The initial funding from the Seaver Institute was the startup funding. Dr. Richard Pyle and I had been trying for the better part of 10 years to get somebody to believe in us, that we could do this. And initially, we weren't very successful, but while we were trying, the technology got better and better and better. And by the time Victoria Seaver came and examined this project, the technology was ready. And she has a degree in ocean engineering. She recognized this, that this was feasible, that we could move forward, and that it was an important area of ocean exploration. So really, the Seaver Institute started it all. And we're going forward with grants to the National Science Foundation, to the National Geographic Society, and hopefully some private sources to augment the generosity of the Seaver Institute and the trust that they put in us to get this going.